Lord, Heavenly Father, we recognize we are in your presence. Lord, help us to be fully aware of your presence right now in the name of Jesus. As we look at your word, as we look at the way you dealt with your disciples, we understand as your disciples, we might learn how you deal with us. In the name of Jesus, amen. Well, I'll stand now. Yeah, it's all that tree chopping. You're absolutely right, Frank. I thought we was going to be cutting off a few little branches on our tree. And then when Joyce said, no, you see that trunk there? That needs to come off. I was like, okay. Anyway, could you turn in your Bibles, please, to Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8, verse 1. We're going to go right through to 21. So we're going to take this in some of this in large chunks. But I want to read the whole lot in one hit because you actually realize it's all connected. About this time, another large crowd. If you remember, we'd left Jesus. He'd just healed a deaf man with a speech impediment. And people were really excited about this Jesus, yes? They couldn't stop talking about him in the Gentile land, yes? And me challenging you, going, do you get that excited about knowing Jesus? And then that was that general sort of, nah. So, here we go. About this time, another large crowd had gathered. And the people ran out of food again. Jesus called his disciples and told them, I feel sorry for these people. They've been here with me for 3 days and they have nothing left to eat. If I send them home hungry, they will faint along the way, for some of them have come a long distance. His disciples replied, how are we supposed to find enough food to feed them out here in the wilderness? Jesus said, how much bread do you have? 7 loaves, they replied. So Jesus told all the people to sit on the ground. Then he took the 7 loaves, thanked God for them, and broke them into pieces. He gave them to his disciples, and who distributed the bread to the crowd? A few small fish were found too, so Jesus also blessed these and told the disciples to distribute them. They ate as much as they wanted. Afterward, the disciples picked up 7 large baskets of leftover food. There were about 4,000 people in the crowd that day, and Jesus sent them home after they had eaten. Immediately after this, he got into a boat with his disciples and crossed over to the region of Dalmanutha. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had arrived, they came and started to argue with him. Testing him, they demanded that he show them a miraculous sign from heaven to prove his authority. When he heard this, he sighed deeply in his spirit and said, why do these people keep demanding a miraculous sign? I tell you the truth, I will not give this generation any such sign. So he got back into the boat and left them, and he crossed to the other side of the lake. But the disciples had forgotten to bring any food. They had only 1 loaf of bread with them in the boat. As they were crossing the lake, Jesus warned them, watch out, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod. At this, they began to argue with each other because they hadn't brought any bread. Jesus knew what they were saying, so he said, why are you arguing about having no bread? Don't you know or understand even yet? Are your hearts too hard to take it in? You have eyes, you can't see. You have ears, can't you hear? Don't you remember anything at all? When I fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread, how many baskets of leftovers did you pick up afterward? 12, they said. And when I fed the 4,000 with 7 loaves, how many large baskets of leftovers did you pick up? 7, they said. Don't you understand yet? He asks them. And all that point, we all look at that last bit and go, nope, don't understand at all. Let's take this in chunks. First and foremost, the feeding of the 4,000. Sounds very similar to another story we heard earlier on in Mark. Oh, the feeding of the 5,000. There are some scholars, etc., that see there is such a close likeness to the feeding of the 5,000 that they believe it to be the same story, really, the same miracle that had occurred. Just being told twice by Mark to try and emphasize something about maybe the Gentiles also having an overspilling of the kingdom of God from the Jewish Messiah. And they could be justified. There is much alike. Both are happening in deserted areas. Both repeat the question, how much bread do you have? People are told to sit down. The people ate and were satisfied. Leftovers are gathered. And both with Jesus dismissing the crowd and him leaving on a boat have very similar connections. But there are also a number of differences. Firstly, in the 5,000, there is specifically a count of five loaves and, go on, two fish. I always go five fish and two loaves. Don't ask me why, it's just something in my head. I know it's five loaves and two fish. Here, we've got seven loaves and a few small fish that are found. Plus, there are two differences. The word for fish in both stories are different. The one here used here that I've just read in the 4,000 is actually the word that's used for sardines. Apparently the locals in the Gentile region, sardines was their main staple diet. Personally, yuck. Yeah, it might be brain food. Somebody else can have it. Oh, sorry, I can't. I'm sure there's people here who love sardines. I can't do fish. I can't do fish. Anyway, I'm glad I'm born in England 2,000 years later where I can eat anything else other than that. Plus, the numbers are very different. In the 5,000, we know that's 5,000 men that are counted, plus others. Here, it is specifically about 4,000 people in total. So, at long last, hallelujah, there's a moment in the gospel where actually men and women and children included together. Let's have a... Amen. There you go. Thought you might like that one. So it's a complete number. Plus the 5,000 feeding, the people were only with Jesus for one day. Here in this story, the people are with them for 3 days. The 4,000 are not asked to break into groups as they are in the 5,000. They're asked just to chill out, ready for a picnic. Sit where you are. And clearly, the number of baskets are left over, and the word used for basket also, by the way, is actually different in the two stories, the Greek word that is used also. So there are distinct differences. The reason I'm going into that, because some people really do get confused, and they do wonder if it's the same story been deliberately adjusted and manipulated, but doesn't most certainly feel like that. There is nothing wrong in sort of looking at this story and saying, well, Jesus is clearly showing that actually the Gentiles are just as satisfied as the Jews are in God's kingdom. But then we know later on, and I read it to you, while they're in the boat, Jesus needs to argue the toss between, when you had the 5,000, what did you get? When you had the 4,000, how many baskets? And it's a reflection that he's having with the disciples here. And I think there's more significance in the argument on the boat. And that's what Mark is trying to show us, rather than this concept of this overspill for the Gentiles. We've already seen that with the dog woman. Do you know, she's going to be really... When I'm going to get to heaven, I think she's going to have words with me. I am not a dog woman, but you know what I mean. So let's jump through verses 1 to 10. Just want to point out things here very quickly. Interesting for me, the disciples are both in the 5,000 and the 4,000. Their role is to serve out what he has blessed. Their role is to dish out to everybody. That's our role as church. Said it last week, we're blessed to bless a world in... pieces. It is our role as people who take the provision that God gives, be it through material possessions, be it through spiritual gifting, be it through practical gifting, whatever, but there is no separation, they're all. But it is our role to use that and meet that out, to serve that out. When we pray, God, do something in this world, God says, yeah, I will do. I use you. I'm sure, given half a chance, Jesus could have actually blessed those loaves, blessed those fish, and then put them in baskets and allowed them to sort of float out. You've got a picture in your head now of all these baskets going out, floating. And some people now probably thinking, he's thinking Harry Potter. No, I'm not. But do you see that? What, get the position. You can see them floating out. But he doesn't. He's very practical. Here you go. You disciples, your role to go out and to dish it out. So, I think we still need to remember that. And the second thing for me here, at the feeding of the 5,000 plus, they were there. Disciples were at the feeding of the 5,000, yes? They were there. They saw all these basketfuls going out. And their question was, how are we going to do this? We haven't got enough. But Jesus, got that sorted. Got 5 loaves, 2 fish. Done. Bosh. Yeah? So here we have in the 4,000 moment, verse 4 in chapter 8, disciples replied, how are we supposed to find enough food to feed them out here in the wilderness? Get the point? What is it we've learned so far? Nothing. They've learned nothing. They ask exactly the same question. So what does that tell us about us?
When we find ourselves in a difficult situation, and God delivers us from that situation, we eventually, by and by, we find ourselves in another type of difficult situation. But we forget the previous difficulty that God has delivered us from. Now we're wondering if he's going to help us sort this one out.
Thank you, Bethany. Yep. Anybody else? There's more to that.
We're very slow learners.
We're very slow learners. This as a teacher.
That's exactly what I was going to say.
No. Second time is good. It's a way of emphasising. Things doubled in the Bible.
We may be slow learners.
Maybe. I'll go with we are. There's no maybe, Tony. Note I include myself in that.
We've got the memory of a goldfish, so we really don't recall very well the good things that God has done for us.
Absolutely. Anybody else? Goldfish or sardine? I can never.
I think we haven't committed our lives fully to God's work.
Thank you, Dennis. We'll come back to that later, actually.
We underestimate God's power. Each time he takes us through something and we thank him for that, we go on to the next thing and then we think, no, this is bigger. This is too big. God can't help in this situation. And so we just forget that God is all powerful and will continue to help us. Yeah.
We don't have enough faith and God is big enough more than our problems.
Yep.
We experience something, we may even remember it, but we haven't allowed that experience to change our mindset, the way we think about things, the way we approach things. It's just an experience, which is throttling around, but not actually a change, changing us.
Thank you, Denzel. And last one, Carol.
Hi. Could they have, you know, been more prepared and thoughtful in advance? I mean, Jesus sounded a bit exasperated. I mean, couldn't they have, you know, things. Like, you know, we're having international night in 2nd of December and, you know, we're going to need a lot of food. There will be anything between 100 and 130 people. But, you know, you've got to plan that way in advance. So you can have a bit of forethought.
Yes, but when you've got 4,000 people, I think there's only so much, and you're not suddenly... you're not exactly suddenly expecting Carol to suddenly go. I think there's a slight difference between the international evening, we're going to feed maybe less than a couple of hundred, and we all know in advance what's happening. Well, all of a sudden, you're running 120 miles. Remember, Jesus had walked about 120 miles, travelled 120 miles within the Gentile land. This is near the end of that journey. And therefore, then, you're not expecting to pick up 4,000 odd people along the way. And I agree with all of that. It was interesting for me, we talk about us and what God can provide for us and how forgetful we are, which we are. But we also got to recognize that when I said to you, about us dishing, it's our role to dish out God's blessing upon people. I think we look at people's situations, other people's situations, we might pray about it, but we pray with lacking in faith that God's going to be able to actually do something for them. Do you remember last week I talked about that prayer and that wonderful coverall prayer we all seem to do? Lord, heal this person in the name of Jesus. And when they go to the doctors, or they go to the pharmacist, when they take their Nurofen later, or any other make and model of ibuprofen, when they take all of that, Sainsbury's, Tesco, anyway. When you know, we say that, so when they take that, cure their headache. Did you see what I mean by the coverall prayer? And I think that's the lack of faith. Not deliberately, not we don't want to, but I think we struggle with that. God's provision is there. We forget about it so quickly. And as Denzel said, we are not transformed up here. We are not renewed in our minds when God does something. We jump onto the next thing. It's almost like paying off a credit card bill. You pay it off one month and you build it up for the next month and you keep forgetting what you're meant to be doing is recognizing that things are, you don't have to, do you see what I mean? You get caught into a loop cycle. And I think this is what's happened. I can't believe you said it with a sense of, well, the disciples really couldn't remember what happened the last time around. And then when you reflect on yourself, you go, nope, because we don't. Something we can learn for ourselves, that we readily forget God's supply when problems come our way, but also come for others in our lives their way. And we forget the ready supply of how God can answer the prayer with his abundant provision. I was saying to Carleen earlier, who led incredibly well this morning, and all of the elements she threw in and tear and stuff, but we talked about the vast floodgates of God's mercy, that's God's provision. And then what we do for communion, here's a little bit of bread and here's a little bit of wine. Oh, wait, sorry, it's not wine, here's juice. Now, I'm not knocking that. I appreciate we can't be prepared and feed like a couple of hundred a decent meal every Sunday. But the point is, the imagery that we use, we talk about it, we have this sense, but the imagery in communion is very, if you think about, I don't know if I do, maybe it's me, maybe I'm very visual minded. But like when I'm thinking about the provision, I want to see like a feasting table. Because God is just abundant in his feasting table, in what he did in that moment on that cross, and what he can continue to do today for us and for those around us when we pray. When we boldly approach his throne room and say, Lord, sort this. And by the way, when he goes, who am I going to send? You go, here I am, send me. We need to remember. We need to recall. It does actually say, count your blessings. Let's be honest, pretty lousy at it. I think the reason we forget is because actually in this Western world that we live in, we expect life to be utopian. Actually, the majority of the policies and the way that we think and the way we're taught is to strive for a day of happiness and hedonism. Party on, people. Oh, I've sent up Bill and Ted. Party on, dudes. It's that sort of lifestyle that we're working towards. If you don't know idea what I mean by Bill and Ted, see me later. Great sci-fi comedy. You're definitely, thank you, John. They are missing out. Anyway, moving on. Where was I? Yes. The point is, and that's the point, so what we do when something, when troubles come way or people in our lives, when that's resolved, we sort of forget about it because what we're trying to keep striving for is, oh, okay, that one's dealt with. Oh, life should look good. You go about 2 days step down the road and then something else comes your way and you go, no, that can't happen. And then you forget that God's provision was there in the first place. Seriously, how many of you actually come to church and afterwards think, oh, I can't wait to go home for dinner. Oh, I can't wait to chill out in front of the TV, fall asleep. I saw some males, where I could embarrass you right now if you want, but I won't. But yeah, well, see what I mean? And there's nothing wrong in that, in taking rest. This is Sabbath day for you. There's nothing wrong in taking rest. That's absolutely right. But actually, that's some of how we, our thinking is. Oh, I can't wait for the working day to be over today. Yeah? Oh, go home, have dinner. Oh, and crash. And hopefully, shut that front door and no problems will appear in your household. That's how we think. So I said I'm looking forward to the knocking on the door this Monday. Mind you, I am spending an hour of it here at the Shekinah evening. Yep, at peak time. Well, we're probably going to walk out on the streets this Shekinah and distribute the bags out to those we see along the road. Anyway, let's not forget God's provision. Let's try and always remember them. Verses 11 to 13. So, Jesus is left on the boat, clearly gone back to land, and there are the Pharisees. There are the Pharisees. Well, they genuinely in their heart thought they were doing the right thing. That's the problem. And we're going to understand that in a moment. First and foremost, the Pharisees. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus arrived, they came and started to argue with him. By the way, that Greek word came isn't that they just strolled up. All right, Jesus, let's have a word. Let's have a chat, shall we? Wasn't like that. It actually has the connotation that they came out in military rank file. Yeah, yeah, has a different meaning now, doesn't it, when you realise it, eh? A heavy mob came out. But it genuinely is that they came out with a sort of almost in a platoon style. That's what that word means. It's a real emphasis of military action to go and challenge Jesus. And this arguing, when it says here, and they started to argue with him, really doesn't. I mean, who's ever had a really decent argument with someone? Do you know, I love the fact that some of you got your arms crossed. Do not tell me you've never argued with anybody. Last time I checked, you were human, amen? Yeah. Then you've argued with someone. If you haven't, then you have some repressed feelings. Come and see me later. I don't argue with anybody for at least while I'm at church on a Sunday morning. And an argument with somebody in the shopping centre. Anyway, moving on. Well, they falsely advertised something and I couldn't leave it. I had to say something. Anyway. Yeah, I know. So I wasn't in my clerical collar. So they come out in this military rank to fight with Jesus. And they're demanding a sign from heaven. Now, we sometimes read in the New Testament miraculous signs. So we're thinking, well, have they not heard about the healings he's doing? They not heard, seen about the demons he's cast out? They know that his teaching is amazing and beyond normal understanding. What's up with these Pharisees? Have they not got by these miracles that he's done? It's not miracles they're looking for. What they're looking for is a sign from heaven to justify his authority. It's almost like they want God to go, this is my son. Oh, he did do that in his baptism, didn't he? But they don't register that. It's almost like they want God to do like a Moses type sign. Do you see? And you think, okay, that's not too bad a thing to request, surely. Well, what he's doing should be enough. But in Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 1 to 5, it does actually say, suppose there are prophets among you, or those who dream dreams about the future, and they promise you signs or miracles, and the predicted signs or miracles occur. If they then say, come, let us worship other gods, gods you have not known before, do not listen to them. So even in Old Testament times, people were able to perform miracles. Yeah? And it's so easy to follow a miracle worker. I mean, I'm not knocking illusionists, etc., that you see on TV these days. You know, they're great illusions, and they don't purport to be anything else but illusionists. They're doing these great things with suddenly there's a mobile phone, and all of a sudden there's the mobile phone in the mirror. I mean, I'd love to know how they do it. I really want to know how they do that. But people can get caught up in following them. When we do miracles and stuff like that, when we perform works of wonder, or you know that somebody's been healed, or you've had a word of knowledge for someone, you don't say, that was all me, do you? You say, that was God. And here, not once, if you think about Jesus' teaching, did he at all point to himself. He always pointed to the Father. The problem also with the Pharisees is that their central place of worship was the temple. And Jesus is clearly not teaching that the temple is now where God rests. So for him, for them, he probably is distracting away from God, but he's not. He's saying, no, I'm still pointing to the Father. I'm just saying, basically, the temple's had it. It's finished. God's had done with that. I'm the new temple, and you'll be the new temple when I die on the cross. So you can understand some of their argument. But Jesus said, I've had enough. What else do you need? What else do you need? Question wasn't planned, but I think I'm going to ask it. What does it mean then? If Jesus' miracles that he's performing weren't enough, what does that say for the Pharisees to see that he is of God? What does that say for us today? I believe very strongly that the church in the West doesn't use the majority of the resources in regards to healing and stuff like that we should do. I think we don't abandon ourselves sufficiently onto that. I will make that bold statement. We don't do that. In using the prophetic word as well into the workplace and into the lives around us. There are some that go the other extreme that I will then say that actually, oh, we need these signs and these miracles or else people are never going to know that God exists. So it's not worth doing anything else until these signs and miracles start happening. Well, that also can't be true. Because we hear of the Pharisees saw it, heard it, made it happen. But guess what? They still believe in Jesus. So it's the both. What is it? It's love that's the difference. It's love. When you show love, people see Christ. Now, in the process of showing love, if you really openly love a person, you may not like them, by the way, but you know that they need Christ in their lives, so you love them for that reason. Then God can do stuff through that in his abundance. Okay, let's get into the real argument and the meat. In the boat. I do love this, but the disciples have forgotten to bring any food. I wonder if really one of their main tasks of disciples is to make sure that there is provision. I mean, what's up with them? Tesco's is open 24/7. What's their problem? Ah, you laugh, but it's amazing. Go on holiday to a place where they don't open 24/7. It's amazing how quickly you get caught out. Remember many years ago when Joy and I were on holiday visiting family and stuff of hers in Australia. And first I got confused because Woolworths is over there. So I was thinking the Woolworths that we had here, and it wasn't. Their Woolworths is like our sort of Asda stroke Tesco's, yeah? So I got a bit confused. But what really baffled me was most of these places shut by 5 o'clock. Not 5 o'clock in the morning, but 5 o'clock in the afternoon. It threw me completely. I'm not quite sure how it is now because it was many a year ago. But it's easy how one can be caught out. Anyway, they only had one loaf of bread with them in the boat. As they were crossing the lake, Jesus warned them, "Watch out, beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod." Now, doesn't that seem a bit weird? We have Mark talking about one loaf, and then Jesus talking about the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod. That word "watch out," by the way, in the NLT, it's got with an exclamation mark. Normally when it's an exclamation mark, it's really emphasizing something. But it's not shouting so much, it's actually a command. So it's not like a warning, like, "Oh, watch out for that flying pig. Duck!" That's a warning of be careful, yeah? This is a warning of beware. It's a command. It's a duty to you. Beware. Remember I said Mark is always about conflict in some form or another and commanding. So it's a real command. Don't take it lightly. Don't go, "All right, we'll take the advice and I'll think about it later." It's actually a command. So if you were in the army, etc., and you were walking out and your commanding officer said, "Beware of flying bullets," you'd take that as a command, wouldn't you? And you'd just go, "That's all right, just do as I please." So when we got here, Jesus saying, "Beware, watch out," we got to see it as a command, as a real, okay, got to be alert. So then, the disciples, as they began to argue with each other because they hadn't brought any bread. Nobody see that's funny. Jesus talks about be aware of the yeast of the Pharisees, so they start arguing with each other about bread. Now just think about it for a minute. You laugh, but what about in church? Seriously? I think Jesus is trying to give a much bigger picture here. What do they start doing? Arguing about something really trivial. What are you worried about? One loaf. You just know that he's just fed 4,000 or plus people. Do you really think he's going to let his disciples go starving? Yeah? Just take that for a minute. So not only have they forgotten the 5,000 when they were doing the 4,000, but they've gone down to the 4,000, they're still forgetting themselves. And think God can't provide with this one loaf. And then Jesus is trying to give this massive picture, beware of the yeast of the and they're going, "Right, your fault, we only got one loaf of bread." Blame game starts. Oh, the blame game. How's that in the workplace these days? Does that still exist? Yeah. Still works in the household as well, doesn't it? Yeah. "Who didn't put that cup in the dishwasher?
I did it, and him over there.
I didn't have a cup of tea." "Well, it's got coffee in it, so it's got to be your fault." We're into the blame game. And this is what it looks like. They're into the real blame game. But they're still not seeing the bigger picture that Jesus is trying to get at. Now, yeast. Yep, I haven't baked bread in months, so I can't use this analogy too much because else I'll be in trouble when I get home later. But yeast, as we know, it's a main ingredient within bread, is it not? If you want your bread to rise, you need to have some yeast. And yeast, though you are, when you think about it, when I do bread, I'll get me 500 grams of flour, me 7 grams of salt, Yeah, you're getting a bakery class now, right? Don't call me Paul Hollywood. So, Great British Bake Off. Isn't it a shame that's going to Channel 4? Anyway, moving on. So, 7 grams of yeast. It's really nice to see the can, this one. And you do it, you put that together, and we get your yeast, and you think, 7 grams of yeast? So there's 500 grams of flour, 350 milligrams of water. I'm remembering, this is good, isn't it? Yeah, I might make some later. Note the word might. But you think that 7 grams of yeast, that's so small compared to all that much ingredient. And yet, without it, the bread wouldn't become what it is. A beautiful loaf, goes great with cheese when it's warm. Anyone want their lunch? And here we've got Jesus using this analogy of yeast in the teaching of the Pharisees and something to do with Herod. Now, Herod and the Pharisees shouldn't be connected in Jesus' saying. What's he trying to say? The reason being is the Pharisees couldn't be far much more removed from Herod. Because Herod wasn't into, Antipas wasn't into what the Pharisees were up to. He was almost non-God-like. Well, let's look. Firstly, the Pharisees, as we know, really did lay lots of rules and regulations upon people, didn't they? Do you remember that? What they considered work on a Sabbath? If you took so many steps on Sabbath, it's considered work. Yeah? So they just put a religious burden on you that basically the idea of following Yahweh was just felt oppressive. We, as Andy quite rightly said this morning, we do that to ourselves as well. We put burdens and regulations on ourselves in following Christ that he hasn't put on us. This is my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me. It's not a lie. So the Pharisees did that. So Jesus is saying, watch out for their yeast. Their little insipid one-liners will really permeate through you. Grow and grow. And believe you me, the bread won't be nice. Herod. What does Herod represent? Well, Herod probably represents what we would say today as secularism influence. He wasn't really interested in God. He was interested in power. Knock God out of the equation. Herod's got all the power. Secularism has exactly the same idea. Knock God out of the equation, not just the Christian, any means of a God, any means of a faith, and then secularism has the power. And how does that manifest itself? Well, through governments. I'll be blunt. Through into the educational system. Once it has the power, people have nothing outside of what they know and what they see before them. Allow that little yeast of secularism to start getting into here. And it's like what Carlene said in Sunday club. There is loads of you went to Sunday school. That sat in you, didn't it? That yeast of that permeated. That was a good stuff, good yeast. That permeated in you and still sat within you and still grew within you. Yeah? Okay, but you go into any means of education or watch a TV program, a particular potline that tries to remove God out of it, that little bit of yeast will sit in people generations to come and they get to that point where they say there is no God. And this is what we have here. We have Jesus saying, beware of it. Why is he saying that to them? Well, to be honest with you, when they started arguing about the bread, that goes to show how narrow-minded they had become very, very quickly. And the teaching of the Pharisees and the teaching of Herod had actually already started to get into them. The fact that Jesus refused to show a sign, I bet the disciples started thinking, why has he refused to do that? Has he actually really got the authority of God to do this? And they start talking. Why didn't he just show them a sign? They've done with it. And then they start thinking, oh, are we following the right bloke? If all these people over here, all our religious authorities over here and Herod are sitting here going, we don't agree with this one man, Jesus, surely not all these people can be wrong. Yeah? And that's how the yeast starts working its way in. And so the disciple could start really questioning who Jesus is. And really, has the authority of heaven, of God, actually really in this Jesus? So his command to them is, beware. Don't allow that to start permeating into your thinking. So how does that affect us today? Let's think about that now for today. I know I've already done some of that already. I didn't expect to. I do apologise. The idea was to be a question. But think about that for a minute. How can we start allowing the yeast of not good teaching get to us?
I think by following some policies, if you're in a workplace that you think this doesn't actually feel right, but because it's a policy and you've been asked to do it, you go ahead and do it anyway, and in your conscience you're thinking, this is not right.
Okay, thank you. And actually sometimes you follow those policies because you're worried that you'll lose your job, and you forget about the provision of God. Sorry, Bethany, was your aha up?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And also, you might tend to think if everybody else is doing it or believing it or whatever, it must be right.
Must be okay. Yeah, everybody else is doing it, why not?
It must be good, and then you are automatically led astray, yeah?
Yeah, this is very true.
Just thinking in the same way that Lorraine was saying, sometimes we underestimate God's power, we can do the same with things that aren't of God. We can underestimate the influence that they have over us.
Yes, absolutely, yeah. I was reading a book recently by Tozer, and I'm going to try and, if you've ever done A.W. Tozer, if you want your head hammered for a while, suggest reading it. Because he's hard-hitting, he doesn't pull his punches at all. And one of the things he turns around and says is, you know, problem is in the West, we've so denied the strength of the evil one, so denied his influence, that we almost believe that it's just having a bad day, and we may not actually recognise what is going on with the evil one. When these thoughts, these little insipid nuggets of yeast thoughts get in, unless you notice it very quickly, it can grow, and you don't realise actually his power behind that is Satan ultimately. He's not worried about you, he's just worried about dethroning God. It was really interesting. The problem with the disciples were they were close to Jesus. They were actually with him every day. And I think they'd fallen into the trap of believing that they really knew him and they really knew his mission. But actually, what they hadn't noticed over the couple of years they were with him, they'd become hard-hearted and were starting not to see properly. That's why Jesus then questioned it. You have eyes, can't see? You have ears, can't you hear? Don't you remember anything at all? They had let the world view take over. They had started probably believing some of the press that they were hearing, especially when Jesus refused to give a sign to the Pharisees. That's when they probably started doubting. You'll probably find way before they'd heard, you know, imagine when they first started out in ministry with Jesus, they see all these challenges that are going on, probably heard people going, he can't be of God. He can't be of God. No, surely God doesn't work like that. He works through the temple. And could you imagine that slowly over a couple of years? You'll remember those little one-liners, don't you? And it is permeating, and it comes to that crescendo moment, just as the timer on the oven goes, ping, your bread is ready. Because he didn't give a sign, ping, oh, this all makes sense. So Jesus gets on the boat with the disciples to take them away from that sort of bad yeast. But strangely enough, it had already been sitting in the disciples. Jesus might have tried to take his disciples away from it, but it was already rooted in them. And the same goes with us. We might come into church here and want to ignore the world out there, but what we bring in is the yeast of the stuff that we listen to out there. Great quote from Edwards. If intellectual and spiritual blindness lead to hardness of heart, blind faith without content must inevitably lead there as well. You hear some strange things that Christians say. I've got the Holy Spirit living in me. Amen? And that's true. Amen? But that's all they seem to rely upon. I forget to read the Bible. I forget to study the Bible. It's not just reading it. It's actually diving in it, grabbing it for its meat, pulling it apart, finding out what's in there, making that transform and change your mind. By the way, when it says be renewed, be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that's not just by the Holy Spirit. You have to read God's word. You have to be around fellow brothers and sisters at time to test things with them. I mean, it does make me laugh. We're happy to take large chunks of TV. Large chunks of, I don't know, non-Christian books. Large chunks of non-Christian friends' worldview and take it on board and go, yes. But we seem to struggle to take last chunks of this book that is before us because we think it's boring. Now, I'm not sitting here for 1 minute saying, from the day I became a Christian, I thought this was the best thing since sliced bread. Oh, there's bread again. Believe you me, my baptism present by my mum was a Bible. For 5 years, I did not get past page one. Oh. Yeah, it's true. I got past the contents page. Yeah, just about. You're right, Denzel. Yeah, yeah. I got to Genesis 1. Thought, this is good. Now, before everybody goes, oh, the pastor says for the first 5 years of being a Christian, he didn't get past it. That's all right for me. No, he's not. If you've been a Christian for at least 5 years, you should have at least read this all the way through once. At which point there's no giggling. Where do we find the door? There's plenty of fantastic reading material, ways to read it in a more interesting way. Don't go from cover to cover. I've done cover to cover. I know somebody else who's doing it cover to cover and just got to that bit with the genealogies, and I did agree with them. It is boring. But then I remember listening and reading a sermon on a guy who said he really wanted to hear from God. He was in a terrible place, really angry at God for months. He said, speak to me, Lord. Opens it up straight into the genealogies. And you can imagine he went, yes, Lord, this is exactly... No, he went, what's this? But forced himself to start reading it, even though that's not what he wanted to hear. And then heard God say to him in the spirit, your name is in there. Not literally was in there, but that is where you are part of me. You're part of this history. You have a name with me. You are part of my family. You get the point. The reason we probably find it boring is because we're not relying on the Holy Spirit. We're trying to rush through it because we think EastEnders will be on in a minute. Oh, see, you're all giggling now. Yeah, yeah, yeah. All whatever daytime TV, Bargain Hunt, that's my one. I confess to that. And what was here was they hadn't got it. And they hadn't got the abundance of God and what he can do. And they hadn't got the leftovers and said, surely, look at all these basketfuls you've been given. That should be a sign enough for you. Because they understood the concept that God gives in abundance. It's throughout the whole of the Old Testament. God's abundant provision. And he said, you've become hard of seeing and hard of hearing. Well, funny enough, today there was during the worship time, John had come up to me and I felt it was, we'd leave it because Andy also had something as well. But the point is, when we say, Lord, I adore you, we actually don't hear God saying back to us, I adore you. Because our ears have become all bunged up because we're listening to what the world is saying, which is, by the way, unless you've got this particular makeup or you're wearing this particular suit or this particular watch, then you are, be careful, Warren, another word I'm looking for. Yeah, rubbish, thank you. That's better. It was coming out with something else. But that's how you feel. I want to use the really strong word because actually that's how we're made to feel by the world. Unless your hair looks a particular style, or you got the right glasses on? Yes, I'm wearing my glasses today. Because I want to go to sleep later. You can't sleep with contact lenses on. So the point is, we think that we're like this because we don't read this enough. And those insipid yeast moments are those adverts. You know when you watch an advert in between your favourite programme? You think about it, watch them critically next time, really with your ears and your eyes open with God, and go, look at the message they are actually giving me. All right? Good. Split you two up in a minute. But do you see the point? I don't want to talk about the trying to figure out the five and the fourth. We're not here for that today. The abundance of God is there. But the insipid yeast that we get from out there is that, as I said in that imagery of communion, there's not much of God. And God hasn't got quite enough for you yet. And he's not saying that. He said, gosh, I love you, you have no idea. Beware. Watch out for the yeast of your world today, says Jesus. This really is exciting when you get into it. So exciting, it actually changes you. Changes you not to remove your sin. That comes naturally. It changes you so you realize who you are in God. And then when you're blessed, you can bless a world in pieces whose yeast needs changing. Let's pray. I want you to hear, not looking at me, I want you to hear God saying to you, I adore you. Nobody's excluded from that. Everybody in this room even if it's my voice you hear saying I adore you, it is God saying to you I adore you. And there should be no yeah buts. Lord, I pray, Lord, Heavenly Father, give us ears to hear and eyes to see. Not just for us, but also for those around us, those who do not know you yet. Lord, I pray, help us to ignore the foul yeast that is sitting within us and help us to be yeast changers for those outside. Help us to be people who change the atmosphere. Help the atmosphere in our heads to be changed as well. As we hear those words, I adore you. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.